300 unreported judgments. We have uploaded reported case law. We have uploaded contact details of lawyers. We have uploaded laws. And we have uploaded articles and encouraged lots of writers to write articles for us and uploaded articles that have been published elsewhere. So we wanted the platform to be a platform where any kind of legal knowledge is available, and legal knowledge is made accessible to people who don't necessarily come to court or who can't access, say, a DLR. And for them, it's to have a website, to have a place where legal knowledge is shared regularly. We thought it is something that we need to take forward, since there was a gap. And with your blessings, we have been taking it forward. Now, about the lecture series, it is something that we conceived about a couple of years back, and we thought we have to create more content for it. Came as a way of creating more content for the website. So we thought, why just articles? Why not videos? Why not lectures? And with that purpose in mind, we approached some honorable judges, and their immediate support actually inspired us and led us to believe that this is something that is possible, that this is something that we can do for every couple of months, and this is something that will help us learn from them in a way that we can't learn from them in court. We have honorable judges talking about specific legal topics, going in depth, and we're also connecting lawyers, law students with this knowledge. And not just the people who are here, not just the attendees here, the beneficiaries of this are worldwide, because we are publishing these videos on YouTube, on our website, and it is accessible anytime, anywhere in the world. So without taking any more time, I would like to introduce our moderator for the day, my respected senior and once my teacher, Barrister Mustafizur Rahman Khan, who will also introduce our speaker. Barrister Mustafizur Rahman Khan.
High Court Division of the Honorable Supreme Court of Bangladesh was a contemporary of mine, in the sense that in the sense that as a mature student of Bhui Academy, our paths had crossed. And as a matter of fact, he is the first person to be elevated to the Honorable High Court Division of the Supreme Court of Bangladesh, whom at one point of time I used to refer to as Bhai. Of course, I have stopped referring to him as Bhai after his elevation to the Supreme Court of Bangladesh, and I have no intention of reverting to that particular form of address until he retires. But on a more serious note, I really look forward to hearing his lecture on today's topic. This topic is particularly poignant for Bangladesh. As you know, Bangladesh finds itself at the forefront of countries which are faced with the challenges of climate change. Even from a historical perspective, environment and the genesis of Bangladesh are inextricably linked. Of course, Bangladesh has been created through a very diverse and complicated political process. But the very genesis of Bangladesh in 1971 was sandwiched between two great climatic events or environmental events. I'm referring, of course, to the cyclone of 1970. One of the immediate causes which led to the creation of Bangladesh, or rather the movement which created Bangladesh gathered impetus from, was the poor response of the Pakistan government to dealing with the aftermath of the November 1970 cyclone. Bangladesh's political history since independence has also been, to a very large extent, influenced by the Great Famine of 1974 and the way in which the governments reacted to that particular event. So I feel that Bangladesh and the environment issue, it goes back a long way. The United Nations Environmental Program have set forth the agenda of 2030 as an agenda for achieving certain goals of sustainable development. And in achieving these goals, the United Nations Environment Program has identified four core principles. These four core principles are universality, integration, human rights and equity, and innovation. Of these four core principles, at least two are one which finds resonance in the law and in the courts. Integration, human rights, and equity. Of the core principles, at least two are ones which play out in the court. In Bangladesh, the framework within which the environmental laws are have been laid down and are enforced are basically found in three legislations: the 1995 Environmental Conservation Act, the Water Bodies Act of 2000, and the Environmental Courts Act of 2010. But apart from these three legislative instruments, our Supreme Court has also played a very bold role in ensuring the environmental rights of the people of Bangladesh. I take particular pleasure in noting that today's guests include the newly elevated judge of the Honorable Supreme Court of Bangladesh, my Lord Mr. Justice Iqbal Kabir. Before his recent elevation to the Supreme Court of Bangladesh, he played a stellar role as part of Bangladesh Environmental Lawyers Association in bringing public interest litigation to the Supreme Court of Bangladesh, where the Bangladesh Supreme Court have had an opportunity to expound on issues which pertain to the environment and have laid down principles and have passed orders with a view to protect the environmental rights of the people of Bangladesh. I look forward to listening to Mr. Honorable Justice A.F.M. Abdur Rahman's lecture today, and I'm sure that during the course of his lecture, you will find that he, so that he can deliver his lecture.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. This is a great opportunity of mine that I have been here. This is the third time I have been here. And on the last occasion, I was a audience here. And today I'm a speaker on certain points. I definitely, I'll take this opportunity, as the moderator has started, the very light mood. And I'll take that opportunity to expose myself in that manner. Mr. Moderator, Mr. Zaman Khan is my classmate. And I and he participated in the examination of 1996 under the University of London. And he was in front of me. I had no time to see who were around me, and I was just writing. One of the time I saw that Mr. Rahman Khan is just leaning his head in his hand. Then thereafter, I came out after the examination. I asked him, but Musafi is key, do you wish to make a wish? Question thing was Gustav Silumna. You can remember it. Today, welcome all of you. I welcome everybody here. And I'm with the topics, role of courts and tribunals in delivering environmental justice, supporting 2030 agenda of UNEP, United Nations Environmental Program. Prior to entering into this topic, it's a very important topic for Bangladesh. I like to draw the attention of this audience to the fresh delivering environmental justice. I leave aside the environmental delivering justice. This is the job we are doing in Bangladesh Supreme Court, and my brothers and sisters are here. All of us were doing all these things. Justice. What does it mean? Everybody here are law students, including us. All of us is a student law, and we are learning for the whole life. I have already in the legal profession for about 35 years, and some of my brothers are also in the same line. We are delivering justice. What does justice mean? Justice means to pay back what he has done in his activity. But what is the concept of justice? Delivering of justice and the concept of justice has got some difference. The concept of justice, if I start with a hypothetical issue, suppose you are driving a car, and the car has, the brake has gone. You are driving the car within a very narrow road. You have seen that 5 persons are in front at the last end of the road, that is a block road. The brake gun, the 5 persons are standing, and you are on 60 mile per hour speed. You are sure that these 5 people will die by your car. Immediately you have seen that there is a diversion road left side. That's also a narrow one. And one person is standing at the last end of that road. Immediately you are to judge. You have decided what would be done. 5 persons in front of you, if you go straight, will be dead. One person in the left, if you divert your car, then one person will be dead. I invite question, volunteer anybody of you. What to do? Anybody? Yeah, that's it.
Brihat Sartar Jono Jodi Kudro Sartar De Kurbani Dewa Jay, Shekhetre Amar Bhalo Hoy. Jodi Ami Straight Jai, Shekhetre Amar 5 Jon Mara Jacche. Jodi Ami মানে লেফট সাইডে ন্যারোর রাস্তা দিয়ে যাই, সেক্ষেত্রে আমার একজন মারা যাচ্ছে। তো সেক্ষেত্রে আমার একজন মেরে যদি 5 জন লাইফ বাঁচাতে পারে, সেক্ষেত্রে মনে হয় বেটার।
গুড, ভেরি নাইস, 1 for 5, দি রিজন ইজ ভেরি গুড, 1 for 5, 1 for 5. নাও আই এম চেঞ্জিং দিস সিনারিও। You are a doctor. You are a specialist. Welcome, Rashna. You are a specialist. You are in your chamber. 5 person came. Every person has got some problem with their organ. Unless that organ is 1 for 5. One man is there having all the full organs, and 5 persons are there are dying. If one person is spared, the 5 person will survive. Now the question, what to do? Any of you, volunteers please. Any answer, volunteers please. The same reasoning, 1 person for 5. Come on. Anybody? Yes? First say something. Yeah, look please.
It cannot be applied because the very conception of justice depends on the circumstances.
That's denied. That's the bold answer. That's the bold answer. Justice is something to be done on the context. That's the main thing, on the context. So, the delivery of environmental justice, it must be on the context. I must not be a judge to keep the environment, to issue of the environment, to uphold the issue of the environment. I must not do anything but will just eradicate everything. What happened? In the delivery of judgment, in environmental judgment, if a judge passes an order, that stops everything in the on the basic on the ground of the environment, will be that a judgment? Will be that a justice? No. The answer is emphatical. No. Then you consider one thing. The Bashkali burning problem is in front of us. The Gondamara village has to spare 6 people for the purpose protesting against the coal-based power plant over there on the issue of environment. 6 people have to be spared by the nation on the issue. Therefore, this issue that the environmental justice, delivery of environmental justice along with the other issues of the nation, especially the development issue, there must be a balance strike in between these two. Development has to be done. And also the issue of environment has to be taken into consideration while the delivery of environmental justice is being done. One thing I can remember, in one of my cases that has been done by Bella, in the case of metro makers, metro makers, if you had been there. In that case, I had to strike a balance in the two issues. The metro makers, that the Mudumuti model town, they have just filled up all the wetlands just outside of Dhaka. And they have sold the plots to 3,000 people of Bangladesh who are just hand-to-mouth earning people. They have purchased the plot. They invested their whole money over there, and the Bella has filed the case against the metro makers on the allegation that the wetlands have been filled up. In that case, Bella was not happy. In that case, I have to strike a balance in the two issue, development and the environmental issue. In that case, I have given the decision that yes, the metro makers have done illegality, but so far the question of the interest of these 3,000 people who have invested their all the money in the film, in the housing estate, has to be considered also. Then the court has ordered that the entire project has to be allowed, approved by the Raja. That was the thing which I have done for the purpose of striking a balance in between these two. Now I'll go for the papers what I will present before you in this respect, the environmental justice, role of courts and tribunals in delivering environmental justice supporting 2030 agenda of United Nations Environmental Program. Yes. I think people will be bored by this long process of delivering a speech. I think it's not a class of a teacher. It's not a class of a teacher. It should be a participatory lecture series. The topics I discuss, the topics I'll just give it to you, it must be participated by you. And the question and answer, I have been asked that whether I will allow. I'll not allow. I'll appreciate everybody to come up with a question and answer on some certain topics on this issue. In the recent time, our world has been experiencing an increased trend of natural disasters, degradation in the environment through the human oblivious and negligent activities, depletion of water and air quality, raising of sea level, poor waste management, pollution of marine water, deforestation, etc. There is no respite to this trend or any sign of slowing down the injustice causing to the environment. From the commencement of the new millennium, negative forces began to show the seeds for the degradation of the environment.
the disintegration of the society and acceleration of unrighteousness. In most of the cases, the world has already set the process of degradation in place. This was due to a rise in man's consumptive and materialistic nature and lack of sense of justice and righteousness. Aided by the higher level of intent, negative energies within the human being, the downslide in the human environment increased in intensity and speed. Over time, this seed has taken root deep in the society and increased the rot in the mankind. As society become more and more unrighteous, they play right into the hands of the negative energies, increasing the impurity in the environment. This increasing impurity causing destabilization in many aspects in the world and culminating in natural disasters, ultimately affecting the world citizen, especially in the third world countries, in their right to life, which is the basic human right as declared in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. The United Nations, being conscious, realized the need to curb the increasing degradation of the environment, initiated its activity under the sub-organization United Nations Environment Program, UNEP. Pursuant to the United Nations Conference on the Human Environment, having met at Stockholm from 5 to 16 June 1972, the conference considered the need for common outlook and for common principle to inspire and guide the people of the world in the preservation and enhancement of the human environment. It declared for the first time that the natural resources of the earth, including the air, water, land, flora and fauna, and especially representative samples of natural ecosystem, must be safeguarded for the benefit of present and future generation through careful planning or management as appropriate. One thing, this is a unique planet. This planet is a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is an entrustment to this present, the present people in the world, the present generation. And this entrustment has to be conveyed to the next generation. In the same status, with the same flora and fauna, to the next generation. But what we people are doing, we are just oblivious about our responsibility as a trustee of the world, this unique plant, which we have to convey to the next generation. So the United Nations has taken this step in their sub-organization UNEP to deal the matter in a right way. 20 years after the first global environmental conference, UNEP arranged another United Nations Conference on Environment and Development, UNCED, popularly known as Earth Summit 1992, held in Rio de Janeiro on 14 June 1992, wherein the United Nations sought to help government rethink economic development and find ways to halt the destruction of irreplaceable natural resources and pollution and the population of the planet. From 23-27 June 1997, many national leaders met again in New York at Earth Summit 2 to review progress since Rio. Welcome, Mr. Justice Rifat Ahmed. This is the place of yours, and I'm using the same thing. Yeah. 10 years after, in the year 2002, the World Summit of Sustainable Development, organized by the United Nations in Johannesburg, was held in August and September of 2002. In this conference, the assembled leaders signed the Convention on Climate Change and the Convention on Biological Diversity, endorsed the Rio Declaration on Environmental Development and the Forest Principle, and adopted Agenda 21, a 300-page plan for achieving sustainable development in the 21st century. These has happened, this has started from the year 1972. It's an ongoing process. The United Nations, in their effort, they have taken this issue very importantly, and they are making this decision one after the decision. And the last decision is the 2030 agenda of UNEP, which we'll discuss in the later portion of the speech. In the 2012, the UNEP organized several heads of state and government to meet in Brazil to renew the commitment to sustainable development and to ensuring the promotion of the economically, socially, and environmentally sustainable future for our planet and for present and future generation. During 5 to 27 September 2015, UNEP further organized Earth Summit 2015 in New York, titled United Nations Sustainable Development Summit 2015 for the adoption of the post-2015 development agenda. In this conference, the United Nations General Assembly formally adopted the Universal Integrated and Transformative 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, along with a set of 17 Sustainable Development Goals and 169 associated targets. In Bangladesh, we are conscious about the resolution adopted by the head of state and government and high representative meeting in the United Nations headquarters in New York from 25-27 September 2015 on new global sustainable development goal to be implemented within the year 2030. The sustainable development goal and 169 target, which the meeting announced, seek to realize the human rights of all in every sphere of life and to achieve gender equality and the empowerment of women and girl child. It is believed that these are integrated and indivisible and balance the three dimensions of sustainable development, the economic, social, and environmental. That we have I have said earlier that the practically the last resolution taken by the UNEP, that's the main goal of the whole to deal with the issue by the United Nations, and not only the United Nations, the whole country of the world, including Bangladesh. Today, my topic is role and relevance of the court, tribunal, and related institution in delivering environmental justice on the theme of setting the scene dynamics of international environmental law and jurisprudence of Bangladesh in Bangladesh perspective. Although the topics I have chosen today with its whole dimension of global implication, nevertheless, as a citizen of this Southeast Asian country, I'll, for obvious reason, direct the topics to keep itself within the context of Bangladesh in order to highlight the very alarming state of environmental degradation occurring in Bangladesh at the very commencement of the new century. More so, Bangladesh is victim of serious international environmental injustice of apprehended threat of sea level rise due to greenhouse gas emission, which may inundate 17.5% of the present land of Bangladesh, displacing 11% of the population of 160 million. In this lecture, my focus will be on the way and means through which we are in Bangladesh deal with the issue of environment, implementation of rule of law in support of the 2030 development agenda, sustainable development goal as taken by the United Nations Environmental Programme. As such, I will expose the state of affairs as prevailing in Bangladesh in the field of environment and the main reasons of environmental degradation, the disparate act of legislature to maintain the biodiversity in order, the rule of the apex judiciary to contain degradation of nature, and the continuous attempt of the social movement organizations to activate the judicial activism to deliver environmental justice. And accordingly, I'll attempt to highlight the effort which we may jointly adopt in support of the proposed sustainable development goal to be achieved in every country of the universe. This is not the only responsibility of the UNEP, rather this is the responsibility of every country of the world to keep the environment in order. Precious life and must be kept safe for the present and future generation. In Bangladesh, we are highly concerned about and understand the environmental right as nothing but to allow the human being to live in decent environment. In this unique planet,
Currently, the environmental rights have been universally recognized as third generation human rights because of the reason that the sole object of living in decent environment is to uphold the right to life. People in Bangladesh under the written constitution have the right to enjoy the right to life as fundamental right irrespective of the people's social and religious status. I am proud to disclose that this issue was continuously revisited by the superior courts in Bangladesh during the last three decades. Environmental degradation caused by direct human activities and lack of necessary steps to contain it in time causes serious damage to injury to human health of a given society, which results in ultimate violation of human rights, not only to that particular society, but the whole civilization at large. Although it is universally recognized by the civilized society that the human life is a precious one and the human rights are required to be protected for protection of mankind, but most of the governmental executives of the countries of the third world until the recent past were practically oblivious on the issue of upholding the basic human rights concerning environment in their country through their municipal law. Of late, due to awareness worldwide as to the greenhouse gas emission, threatening of sea level rise, transboundary problem as to shear river, climate change, etc., environmental laws of countries have been recognized as important part of the international relations. Therefore, by ratifying and accessing a major international instrument and with the help of international organization, achieving of environmental justice can be ensured. The sustainable development and the environmental issue are intertwined in such a manner that achieving the goal of sustainable development is not possible without taking initiative regarding the improvement of environment along with the initiativeness for development. Therefore, the policies concerning environmental justice and the development policies should be taken together at a time. That I have said in the very early of my speech, that this is the two issue. A balance has to be struck in between these two issues. The development and the environmental issue must be taken into consideration in one go. And unless this has been taken in one go, there will be conflict in between these two issues. And as I have said, that in that case we may pass an order in the High Court Division, pass an order to stop everything without considering the issue of development. Right to participation and access to environmental decision-making process impliedly recognize that the higher judiciary of a country can safeguard the art by making environmental justice in appropriate instance. The civil society activism with a demand to implement law, overcome the shortcomings, and to ensure adequate institutional and policy support is developing vigorously in Bangladesh. Such activism now resulted into support and fostered changes in law and institutional attitude and the gradual rise in public awareness. The judicial commitments of the Supreme Judiciary in Bangladesh to uphold constitutional values has been continuing to develop a proper environmental jurisprudence with due regard to human rights and dignity. But the global environmental changes, surfacing factors that remain outside the control of any particular community or state, requires activism on the part of the global community. Sea level rise affecting the coastal belt of Bangladesh is one of such phenomena that has a special pertinence to Bangladesh, which is situated at north of Bay of Bengal, being a low-lying delta. The environmental scientist apprehends that 1 meter rise in the sea level would displace 11% of the population and inundate 71.5% of the total landmass of Bangladesh. The transboundary problem with India concerning the water of shared rivers like Ganga and Jamuna is another glaring example of environmental injustice, which practically causes environmental racism, meaning thereby placing Bangladesh, a third world underdeveloped country, in proximity of environmentally hazardous or degraded environment. In the last decade or so, environmentalists in Bangladesh, the state organ and the citizen group have rightly identified the depletion of environmental resources, environmental injustice, and environmental racism as major causes of poverty in Bangladesh, which has the 8th largest population in the world. Life and livelihood in Bangladesh, especially for the poor, depends deeply on nature. Any undue interference with land, river, water, air, and other environmental resources would inevitably impact the life of the people. The relationship of the people of Bangladesh with nature can be stated from the words of Secretary General of the United Nations, Mr. Kofi Annan, quote, "The great majority of Bangladesh's life in rural areas on the front line of resources management, natural disasters, and environmental awareness. For them, the relationship between human being and the natural world is a daily reality, not an abstract idea. Our biggest challenge in this new century is to take an idea for that seems abstract sustainable development and turn it into a daily reality for the entire world's people," unquote. This quote has uniquely reflected the relationship of nature with the day-to-day life of the general people of Bangladesh, who are currently 160 million in number, living under the high quality of democracy, having independence of judiciary in the strict sense, with free electronic and print media, along with stable economics. The problem of the problem and causes of environmental issue in Bangladesh. Bangladesh is a country of 160 million population, having 143,998 square kilometer landmass, situated on the northern coast of the Bay of Bengal, and is surrounded almost in all sides by India, with a small common boundary with Myanmar in the southeast, with the Himalaya near the north boundary. Bangladesh population is equivalent to 2.19% of the total world population, ranks number 8 in the list of countries by population. The population density in Bangladesh is 1252 per square kilometer. 34.2% of the population is urban. The median age of Bangladesh is 26 years. Bangladesh is gifted with an unparalleled natural panorama. The country is affluent in terms of natural resources and hardworking people. However, it is deficient in terms of sustainable and sound management of these environmental resources. Historically, the law and institution dealing with natural resources in Bangladesh were use-oriented. They were geared towards extracting maximum economic benefit. Sometimes this approach forecloses the interest of future generation. The country is a low-lying riverine land traversed by the many branches and tributaries of the river Podda, Jamuna, Meghna, and Brahmaputra, having hundreds of its branches around the country, making them as the lifeline of the country. Tropical monsoon and frequent floods and cyclones inflict heavy damage in the Delta region. The main issue of degradation in the environment in Bangladesh lie mainly in five points. One is the vast wetland filling for the purpose of industrialization or quick urbanization. Between 2006 and 2013, 44 square kilometers of perennial wetland, 176 square kilometers of flood flow zone, and cropland were grabbed in and around the capital by the housing and real estate developers, even violating the law through which, though these lands were protected area under the master plan for the capital. The low-lying land is the pathway of removal of the rainwater from the capital. There were 127 canals inside the capital city, Dhaka, which disappeared during the last 3 decades due to grabbing. The earth filling of low-lying lands and disappearance of 127 canals is the main reason of water clogging within the city just after monsoon rain every day. In succeeding years, more wetlands and croplands in and around the capital and in other major cities were swallowed by grabbers. 2, contamination of river water and other water sources by the industrial pollutant or waste management. Bangladesh has inter alia five major rivers, namely Padma, Meghna, Jamuna, Tista, and Brahmaputra, along with another sub-major river around the capital city, Dhaka, known as Buriganga. Every day, approximately 700 tannery industries situated within Dhaka city are discharging about 16,000 cubic meters of toxic waste, which are ultimately discharged into rivers. Just think about it. The tannery is that discharging this quantity of toxic materials in the rivers to just simply make dead the whole rivers. More than 200 branches rivers of Bangladesh directly or indirectly receive this large quantity of untreated industrial waste and effluent. These leather processing tanneries industries are one of the oldest industries in Bangladesh. These industries mainly located on the banks of Buriganga, one of the main rivers of the heart of the capital city, Dhaka. They process hides into finished leather using acids and chromium, producing roughly 20 million square meters of leather and leather goods each year. None of the industries have effluent management plant, and most of these, their 3,000 workers work in, 30,000 workers work in chemical field environment without the required protective equipment. The leather industry alone pollutes 26% of the total river water of Bangladesh. People living near these tanneries are exposed to higher morbidity and mortality compared to people living 2 to 3 kilometers away. The other mostly contributing in, one thing, that I do live in this atmosphere. My house is just near the Hazaribagh tanneries, and I live in this this degraded environment of Dhaka. People, the other mostly contributing industries for water pollution in this manner are pulp and paper, pharmaceutical, metal processing, food processing, fertilizer, pesticide, dyeing and painting, textile industries, etc. In effect, they have turned at least 4 major rivers into toxic dump by indiscriminately discharging their waste into it. Contamination of rivers, water due to spouting of poisonous waste coming from these industrial plants situated beside the important rivers is an important reason for increasing water toxicity, causing severe health hazard. The pollution activity is not only confined to the mainstream rivers, but also all other water reservoirs situated here and there throughout the entire country. The river Buriganga, once known as Thames River of Dhaka, the capital city is now transformed into hub of dumping of pollutant of these industries and also from sewerage, causing complete environmental injustice, claiming eliminating fish and other sea lives, marine lives. 3, unplanned urbanization and by hurriedly decided development. Bangladesh, being a north-south speared country with vast majority of rivers situated alongside the north-south direction, any construction of road in the east-west direction shall cause water clogging. But unplanned and hurriedly decided urbanization in the east-west direction caused flooding every year. The hurriedly decided unplanned urbanization and development causing not only disappearance of agricultural land and greenery, but also causes repeated month-long floods associated with hurricane and tornado almost in every year. 4, drying up of rivers due to withdrawal of water from the shared rivers. Bangladesh is mainly an agricultural country, and the cultivation is dependent upon the water of rivers. Unless the rivers supply plenty of water, the agriculture-based economics of the country faces immense consequence. But Bangladesh is a fatal victim of environmental injustice due to withdrawal of water disproportionately in the shared rivers. In this scorching summer, every year, the river Padma, Jamuna, Tista, and Brahmaputra faces serious shortage of water that causes severe drought and consequently negative implication on agriculture at large. Therefore, rivers are the lifeline of Bangladesh. The river network supplies the necessary water to the agricultural field throughout the country through several branches of the major rivers, and thereafter through hundreds and thousands of canals originated from these branches of rivers. Due to this withdrawal of water, Bangladesh is now victim of environmental injustice, which is also another form of environmental racism. 5. Disappearance of greenery through abolition of public parks, agricultural lands, and forest. Parks and open spaces are very quickly disappearing around the cities in Bangladesh due to the erection of trading centers, malls, and other commercial complexes. And in this manner, about 76 parks around the capital city disappeared during the last 2 decades. Air pollution in urban areas of Bangladesh is due to the unburned fuel from the two-stroke engine vehicles. Bangladesh Atomic Energy Commission, in the year 2012, reports that automobiles in Dhaka emit 100 kg leaks, 3.5 tons SPM, 1.5 tons SO2 gas, 14 tons of AC gas, and 60 tons of CO gas in every day. Air pollution also occurs due to burning of fossil fuel like coal, petroleum, etc., and associated black smoke. Over 90% of the brick kilns use fossil fuel but don't comply with the brick kiln ordinance and pollute enormous air. The air quality degradation through the pollution of hazardous transport emission, so far the cities and important commercial hubs are concerned, is another anxiety of the nation as a whole, since a number of life danger disease is related to such air pollution. 7. Seabed rise, current and future threatening. Seabed sea level are rising several times faster than the past 2800 years, and are accelerating because the man-made global warming according to the new studies. Man-made climate change is responsible for fastest rise in sea levels in the past 2800 years. An international team of scientists dug into 24 locations across the globe to chart gently rising and falling seas over countries and millennia. Until the 1880s and the world's industrialization, the fastest rise in sea level was about 3 centimeters to 4 centimeters a century, plus or minus a bit. During that time, the global sea level really did not get much bigger or lower than 7.62 centimeters above or below the 2000 years average. But in the 20th century, the world's seas arose a rose of seabed 14 centimeters. Since 1993, the rate has soared to 30 centimeters, and two different studies said that the 2100, the world's ocean would rise between 28 and 31 centimeters, depending on how much heat-trapping gas Earth industries and vehicles expel. There is no question that the 20th century is the fastest, said Bob Cope, Roger, and the planetary scientist professor and the lead author of the study that looked back at sea level over the past 3 millennia. It is because of the temperature increase in the 20th century, which has been driven by fossil fuel use. Its seas continue to rise as projected. Another 45 centimeters of sea level rise will cause a lot of problems and expenses, especially with the surge during storm, said study co-author Mr. Stephen Rottenhalf. Legislative action to the issue of environment in Bangladesh. Bangladesh, being seriously concerned with degradation of environmental and threatened with seabed rise, it is desperate signatory to almost all international conventions and treaties on the conservation of environment and promotion of biodiversity. She has always demonstrated the spirit to fight back hazards and disasters. The society in Bangladesh is continuously responding to the global call for protection of environment. With the adoption of new sets of laws and rules, the legal regime as it stands today sounds more progressive and sensitive. It has also updated its national legal framework on environment, and in the light of the international norms and standards, especially along with the line of Rio Declaration. Earlier, Bangladesh has legal provisions against committing offense in respect of environments, especially in the Penal Code 1860, which was enacted during the colonial state of the country under the British Raj and adopted as prevailing law after the 1947 independence from Britain. This statute provides, one, punishment for the offense of committing a public nuisance, which covers contamination of drinkable water, two, a negligent act resulting in the infection, which is dangerous to life, three, acts of adulteration of food, drinks and drugs, four, contamination of water and public spring or reservoir to make it unfit for ordinary use, five, poisoning the atmosphere to the detriment of person living in the neighborhood or passing along a public way, six, negligence in use of the poisonous substance, fire and combustible matter, explosive substance and materials, if it results in danger to human life. But this century-old legal provision became obsolete in the contemporary life and as such in little use against the offender of environment. During the post-Rio period, there have been enactment of particular laws in Bangladesh by the conscious legislature concerning conservation of environment and fighting climate effects. The major laws on the area are the Environmental Conservation Act 1995 and the Water Bodies Act 2010, that is in Bangla, Jaladhar Ayn 2010, the rules made thereunder, and the Environmental Courts Act 2010. Another law is contemplating, that is the under the MARPOL convention, that is regarding the pollution of the marine water, that is the Marine Water Conservation Act, that is on the table, and it may come up any time in the parliament. The dispensation of justice in environmental issue are mainly performed by the environmental courts and environmental appellate courts constituted under the Environmental Courts Act 2010. But these courts are not adequate in view of the number of violations of environmental aspect. In fact, there is currently little dearth of laws, legislation or rules in the areas of conservation of environment and biodiversity and punishing the criminal who violates law. The real problem lies in the laws. Now, the real problem lies in the prompt, effective, and even-handed enforcement of these laws. The violators of the environmental laws are powerful people. They have money, muscle, and political backing. As such, in many occasions, they go scot-free. Laws are either not enforced or applied in a manner incompatible to their conservation. To the conservation and sustainability spirit, there is deficiency in the areas of prevention of detrimental act and enforcement of environmental laws and rules, and as such, the independent judiciary in Bangladesh had to invent innovative means to contain the violation of environmental order by way of judicial activism. Environmental justice vis-a-vis the environmental injustice. The concept of environmental injustice may be best understood by referring to environmental injustice. Environmental injustice occurs whenever some individual or group bears disproportionate environmental risk, like those from the hazardous waste dump, polluting river water and clean air, filling wetland and flood flow areas. This could also happen in case of unequal access to environmental goods like clean water and air, or having less opportunity to participate in environmental decision-making process. Particularly, the marginalized sect and poor people face greater environmental risk, have less access to environmental equality, and have less ability to control the environmental insult imposed upon them. Environmental legal activism to contain the environmental injustice referred to the effort of some members of the lawyers community to ensure sound environmental and ecological order by utilizing the legal mechanism and court system as a tool. This includes undertaking legal action against originator of environmental pollution. The environmental justice can be achieved through the meaningful involvement of the people with respect to the development, implementation and enforcement of environmental laws, regulations and policies. Legal activism for the prevention of environmental injustice is the best way of describing the true meaning of environmental justice. These poor sect are always facing this injustice, environmental injustice. I have already said to you what happened in Bashkali. Six people had to be spared for the question of environment. Judicial activism to render environmental justice in Bangladesh. Judicial activism is as believed in the judicial arena of Bangladesh as elsewhere in the world, is that the judges assume a role of independent policy maker or independent trustee on behalf of the society, which apparently goes beyond their age-old traditional role as interpreters of the legal provisions, constitutional and law. Judicial activism is the view that the Supreme Court and other judges can and should creatively interpret the text of the Constitution and the laws in order to serve the judges' own vision regarding the needs of contemporary society. In this line of belief, judicial activism occurs when judges decline to apply the Constitution or laws according to their original public meaning or ignore binding precedents and instead decide the cases based on personal preference. A decision that fails to meet this standard does not express policy disagreement with the outcome, but practically it expresses disagreement with the judge's conception of his or her role in the constitutional system. The concept of judicial activism is the polar opposition of judicial restraint. Critics of judicial activism assert that it subverts the separation of powers of principle and as defined by Dicey. Judges frequently must interpret what the law actually says, but they are often accused of judicial activism or labeled as activists if their interpretation seems to be a rewriting of the law, especially if their rulings strike down or substantially revive laws passed by legislature. The role of the higher judiciary in environmental rules issues in Bangladesh. Independence of higher judiciary to its truest meaning is prevailing in Bangladesh. That's a very correct position. The Bangladesh judiciary is enjoying, the higher judiciary of Bangladesh is enjoying the highest independence. We are not under any command of anybody, either in the executive or in the public. We are definitely independent to interpret the law as it prevails in Bangladesh, along with judicial activism. Justice in the Supreme Court. Now, judges in the Supreme Court exercise their judicial function. In Bangladesh, justice, judiciary, and the rule of law are bound together as an integrated whole according to her written constitution. Similar to other common law countries with written constitution, neither the legislature nor the judiciary is supreme independently, but under the constitution, and the court acts as the final interpreter of law. But the constitution of Bangladesh created check and balance between the two organs of the state, the judiciary and the executive. Under the provision of Article 102 of the Constitution of Bangladesh, the judges of the High Court Division of Bangladesh Supreme Court may issue the writ of certiorari, mandamus, prohibition and quarantio in order to make judicial review upon an application filed by the person aggrieved by an act of the governmental executive or by the local authorities and public bodies. The higher judiciary can interpret the law to give them a sense of harmony and coherence. Since the judges of the Supreme Court in Bangladesh are not elevated to the bench through electoral method, they are more willing to take decision adverse to the government, but beneficial in the long run to the people and environment. With the expression of the meaning of the provision of Article 32 of the Constitution as to right to life, to accommodate environmental protection, an expectation has been created that the highest judiciary in Bangladesh would take more benevolent leadership in deciding environmental cases. In the recent past, this expectation came through the novel method known as public interest litigation, which has already made its way in the environmental issue in Bangladesh. Public interest litigation, PIL, the noble weapon in environmental issue. Public interest litigation is currently a popular concept in Bangladesh, which denotes litigation initiated for the protection of public interest at large, either by an individual or by environmentalist organization. The party initiated the proceeding in this litigation need not be the party aggrieved as traditional record under the judicial review system as provided in Article 102 of the Bangladesh Constitution. This sort of litigation can also be initiated by the court itself upon perusing newspaper report or at the instance of any member of the public by informal manner, which is more particularly known as epistolary jurisdiction. In the High Court Division of the Supreme Court of Bangladesh under its writ jurisdiction in such cases may rest on judicial activism. This is also an example of legal activism by which society can claim redress for an act that is not directly safeguarded by the Constitution and where the state has failed to redress it. The environmental issue are as such redressed under such public interest litigation. Issue of locus standi once the serious hurdle in pale. Until 1994, Bangladesh had no reported judgment on public interest litigation on environmental issue. When aggrieved by the environmental issue, the people had no idea to have redress by way of mass litigation. The environmental activist organization BELA, Bangladesh Environmental Lawyers Association, my brother Mr. Iqbal Kabir is here, he was a lawyer of that organization, isn't it? Is the first attempt to throw an environmental issue in the case of Dr. Mahiddin Farooq versus Bangladesh and others for judicial review under Article 102 of the Constitution as public interest litigation, wherein High Court Division of the Supreme Court of Bangladesh remained strict on the traditional principle of requirement of locus standi of the petitioner. Along with the long-standing unwillingness of the High Court Division as to make any favorable expansion of issue of locus standi. In this case, the legality of the experimental structural project involving flood action plan of Bangladesh was challenged. The High Court Division rejected the petition of the petition on the ground that the petitioner had no standing, but the Appellate Division of the Bangladesh Supreme Court decided the issue of locus standi in public interest litigation and gave its positive decision, in which Mustafa Kamal J. observed, quote, insofar as it concerned public wrong or public injury or invasion of fundamental rights of an indeterminate number of people, any member of the public, being a citizen, suffering the common injury or common invasion in common and others, or any citizen or an indigenous association as distinguished from a local component of a foreign organization, espousing that particular cause, is a person aggrieved and has the right to invoke the jurisdiction under the Article 102. In Dr. Mohiddin Farooq versus Bangladesh and another, the FAP case, Flood Action Plan case, the relationship between the right to decent environment and the locus standi came out clearly. In the appeal, Dr. Mohiddin Farooq argued inter alia that those whose fundamental rights are being violated need not themselves invoke the jurisdiction under Article 102. Other espousing their cause may be so provided the persons aggrieved do not object. He noted the appellant is espousing the cause of violation of fundamental rights of a large segment of the population in respect of the right to life, property, and vocation. In the legal judgment, in the lead judgment, Mustafa Kamal J. agreed and held, quote, the Article 102 is the mechanism for the enforcement of fundamental rights, which can be enjoyed by an individual alone, insofar as his individual rights are concerned, but which can also be shared by an individual in common and others when the right pervade and extend to the entire population and territory, unquote. Having noted this finding, the next important question is whether the protection of the environment amounts to the protection of fundamental rights. On this, His Lordship noted that a petition is concerned with an environmental issue, but that there is no specific fundamental right in the Constitution dealing with the environment. However, he started the question of whether the fundamental rights to life encompasses the right to a decent environment, choosing instead of to rely on the environment of the appellant in making the connection between the environment and fundamental rights. However, in his concurring judgment, Justice B.B. Roy Chaudhury did not shy away from making a direct connection between environmental protection and environmental rights. This has helped the appellant getting locus standi to maintain the writ petition on their behalf. His lordship noted that the protected and preservation of environment, ecological balance, freedom from pollution of air and water and sanitation, without which life can hardly be enjoyed, are within the ambit of the constitution of this country. Recognition of right to decent environment as right to life. This is a long one. I'll skip some of it. The role of the environmental activist. On overwhelming success on the issue of locus standi in public litigation and on the issue of right to decent environment as right to life, the environmentalist organization, apart from BELA, namely BLAST, Bangladesh Legal Aid and Service Trust, ASK, Aino Shalish Kendro, Human Rights and Peace for Bangladesh, headed by learned advocate Mr. Manjil Murshid, and numerous other enthusiastic lawyers like Mr. Yunus Alik Akhan and others have undertaken a large number of cases that have contributed to the development of PIL in the environmental issue in Bangladesh. Among these, the relief sought against wetland filling in the infamous Madhubuti housing case, river water pollution caused by toxic discharge made by the leather tanners industries are prominent. These issues had arisen mainly because the governmental agencies connected are inefficient, biased, corrupt, or do not have adequate strategies to tackle environmental degradation. The drawback of the environmental activist. In Bangladesh, the human rights to a decent environment has been established by few more cases as fundamental rights, where the concept of right to life was expanded through judicial activism. The judicial activism that made this possible is a direct outcome of the activism of the environmental lawyers. In most of the cases, it is those lawyers that initiated the argument which the courts took up in reaching the favorable decision. The path of these environmental lawyers had not been the path of bed of roses, rather hurdle, hardship, and insecurity to life traced these lawyers in their persuasion of the cause. A recent study has surfaced the hard reality that the success of the activism by environmental PIL still have significant problem beyond the limitation of PIL. The environmental social movement in Bangladesh. The campaign for environmental protection in Bangladesh are sufficiently interlinked and sustained to meet most characterization of social movement. The strong participation in these campaigns include, but are not limited to, the Bangladesh Center for Advanced Studies, BICAS, the Bangladesh Poribesh Andolan, BAPA, and BELA, Bangladesh Environmental Lawyers Association. Since 1986, BICAS has been involved in research and publication on environmental issues. It seeks to address sustainable development through A, environmental development integration, B, good governance and people participation, C, poverty alleviation and sustainable livelihood, and D, economic growth and public-private partnership. It has produced a number of publications that have influenced national environment policy. The court apparently as such applied the polluters pay principle. Yet in another petition also related to commercial shrimp cultivation, the High Court Division issued a rule, NYSAI, calling upon the respondent to show cause as to why they should not be directed to compensate the affected people for the loss suffered by them due to the row of saline water over their lands. The activists also hope that the Supreme Court would consider these pending cases from a different viewpoint by positively responding to their arguments and thereby play an instrumental role in implementing emerging incidental international environment law norms in Bangladesh. The legal activists in some instances were successful in not only eliciting favorable court decision, but also in securing positive response from the government in the implementation of the judicial decision. A good example is the Dhaka City vehicular pollution case. Many vehicles in Dhaka City used leaded petroleum and contributed to the emission of lead-based gases. To save the city dwellers from air pollution, Bela filed a petition for necessary direction to control vehicular air pollution in Dhaka City. In that case, the Supreme Court directed the government to inter alia phase out all existing two-stroke three-wheeler vehicles, which were the most polluting vehicles from Dhaka City, by December 2002. Although this was a difficult task, nevertheless, the government implemented the court decision. The government gave the three-wheeler owners many incentives and options and pushed them to the wall to accept these options. For the most part, drivers were rehabilitated in some way or other. Another example may be cited in respect of implementation of protection of river embankment. Pursuant to success in obtaining order from the High Court Division in the rich case initiated by Bela, the government ascertained the boundary of River Balu and Turag around Dhaka City and put concrete pillars to safeguard the same from further encroachment. Later, the government evicted the encroachers from the embankments of River Shitalakha and built pavement along the embankments and planted tree beside it. In implementing the court's order, the government had to fight the mighty political figures and the local hoodlums who had come out with their all-out efforts to frustrate the governmental effort and the court's order. However, the successful implementation outcome has not been replicated across the board. In many cases, the decisions have not been properly implemented. Some of the projects that were successfully challenged by the activists were ultimately executed by the government. Conclusion. The role of the higher judiciary in delivering environmental justice in Bangladesh has entered into its fourth decade. This higher judiciary has taken note of the 17 Sustainable Development Goal and 169 targets which the head of the state government and high representative adopted in the meeting held at the United Nations headquarters in New York from 25-27 September 2015, and accordingly preparing to establish rule of law for supporting the 2030 Development Agenda Sustainable Development Goal in order to respond the international call. This is the important thing we are now dealing in Bangladesh to support this 2030 development goal of the United Nations. Thanking you all. Good day. Assalamu alaikum.
The lecture will serve as a very valuable resource for Think Legal because it has summarized the development of environmental law in Bangladesh. It has touched upon various aspects of concern. During the first part of the lecture, Mr. Justice Rahman commented upon the particular environmental problems that confront Bangladesh. And in summarizing these problems, what I particularly noted with interest was his observation with respect to the density of population in Bangladesh. The density of population in Bangladesh is actually a very interesting statistic, and it is one which I have had occasion to refer to in the past. If the entire population of the world, 7 billion people and counting, were to be concentrated into the 48 states of the United States of America, meaning apart from Alaska and Hawaii, the lower 48, the continental 48, you would still get a density of population in the United States which is less than the density of population of Bangladesh. But even those of us who are more attuned to what is known as what my learned senior refers to as metropolitan practice, so if there are commercial interests which are involved or company litigation, you will often find that the underlying issue has to do with the concerns, perhaps minority protection or rectification of a share register. But the underlying objective of the litigation is to control the land. It has also touched upon the development on the legal framework within which environmental laws are protected in Bangladesh. In particular, while he has noted that the laws in themselves are perhaps adequate, what is lacking is a proper enforcement of these laws. And certainly one of the things which I believe should be considered actively is to set up a separate environmental protection agency in Bangladesh, which will police the enforcement of environmental laws. The Department of Environment, as it stands presently, as a department of the government, is perhaps not adequate. What we need is something along the lines of an independent commission or an independent police force, which would police the environmental laws. My Lord, Mr. Justice A.F.M. Abdur Rahman has also touched upon the role that has been played by the Supreme Court of Bangladesh in dealing with this gap, perhaps, by making use of its special jurisdiction under Article 102 of the Constitution. And in fact, the second half of the lecture would serve as a very useful summary of the development of environmental cases in Bangladesh since the mid-90s. He has touched upon how the Supreme Court of Bangladesh dealt with the initial hurdle of locus standi, how the Appellate Division of the Supreme Court of Bangladesh has held that if the rights of an indeterminate number of people are at stake, then the individual litigant, as part of that indeterminate group, has standing. He has also expressed appreciation for the role played by various civil society organizations in bringing about this particular change. But what I found very interesting is his observation that this also puts the judiciary in a delicate position, because when the Supreme Court engages in judicial activism, it actually, to a certain extent, it exposes itself to the charge that it is supplanting the role of the executive. In summary, let me again express my gratitude. I'm sure not only on behalf of myself, but also on behalf of everyone who is assembled, to Mr. Justice A.F.M. Abdur Rahman for his very illuminating lecture on the topic. I'm sure that the able protagonists of the Think Legal organization would upload this particular lecture into the website, and I'm being told that this is also being videotaped, so it will also be available on YouTube, and in future generations or in future days to come, I'm sure that this particular lecture would be referred back as a very valuable resource for those who are interested in this particular subject. So thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Larger agenda in terms of, you spoke about the commissions, Mr. Fuzur Rahman. Bangladesh now remains a frontier state as far as climate change is concerned. And globally, as hinted by Justice Abdur Rahman, we take a very robust stand. In fact, we take a leadership role in terms of limiting the rate of emission, as it were, as witnessed in Paris. And I think I can divulge the fact that efforts are on the way for the fifth South Asia Roundtable on Environmental Justice to be hosted in Bangladesh under the aegis of the ADB and the Supreme Court of Bangladesh later this year. And the agenda will be, where do we go from environmental protection to addressing climate change in a meaningful manner, and what will the role of the courts be? In the immediate neighborhood, Pakistan of late has set up the Climate Change Commission, and that was a purely judgment-driven effort on the part of the Lahore High Court. And so I think that Justice Abdur Rahman, you made a very timely intervention, and you've set the agenda for the next year and the years ahead for judges, practitioners, and social activists working in environmental protection and indeed climate change. Thank you very much.
Attended a conference in Delhi organized by the Green Tribunal of India, National Green Tribunal of India, on the same subject. Therein I have seen the agony of the whole world community in dealing with the environmental issues. The environmental issue is not only the issue in Bangladesh, rather the Indian subcontinent countries, Pakistan, India, Sri Lanka, Maldives, Afghanistan, all these countries are victims of these environmental issues. And everywhere, there the peoples are so active in containing this degradation. But alas to say, we people are not that much conscious. And it should be our aim right now to convey this message to the general mass, that you are to contain this degradation of environment by yourself. Each and every people must be entrusted with the duty to keep the environment in order. That I have said earlier, in order to convey the entrustment of this planet to the next generation. However, I must say one thing. You see, in the year 1957, there was a Marpol conference regarding the marine water pollution. And in the year 2005, there is an attempt for a enactment in the parliament regarding the Marine Water Pollution Protection Act. But sorry to say, that is still under the table. Not on the table, under the table. So this is our progress in this issue. So it is the duty, I because think little, that on this issue you should do something to convey this message to the whole nation. Otherwise we'll be failing in our duty to just transfer our responsibility as a trustee of the planet to the next generation. Thank you. Anybody to ask any question on the matter?
When it's with regards to climate change, the need for food security and the protection of the environment, because agriculture is a big contributor to degradation of the environment. So how do we reach a balance? At least how can the legal system contribute to reaching a balance? Sir, I'm Noreen Ahmed. I'm an associate at the legal circle.
Yeah, that has I have said in the very initiation of my speech in the first part. That they have a hypothetical the scenario I have given you, how to balance in the concept of justice, concept of judgment, that you have to take the issue in hand in one go. You have to consider the need for development and also the need for protection the environment. So you see what happened in Bashkan. The people, the asylum group, they just got there and started constructing the power plant, coal-based power plant over there, without asking any of the agency whether it has got any impact upon the environment or the people. But why? Because law is there is no implementation. Nobody can, nobody says, I'll tell one thing, you just go to Gulistan, put a cart on the center of Gulistan road, and lie there and sleep. Nobody will ask you anything. The bus will go by around you, but don't ask you why you are sleeping here in the Gulistan in the middle. What does it mean? It means there is no implementation with that here. The police is there, they do not do any work. The law is there, it is not being implemented. So what happens? You are asking for a balance to be striking between these two issues. Yes, when the policy is being taken, these two issues has to be taken into hand. And it must be known to the public that this government is going to do something in somewhere which has got the effect on the environment. Nobody does. Nobody says anything. They start working. Then when it happened, what happened to the flyover in Mombasa, in Mocha? What happened? They have constructed the flyover by keeping the people right side. Now it appears there are the people
to go by left side. So demolish it. In the meantime, thousands of crores of money have been expended. So this is the matter in Bangladesh going on. Policy is being made in the secretariat, sitting in the chair, not on the spot, not going to the locality. These are the things that the balance is not being struck in between these two issues. So I thank you that this awareness must come to the policymakers, that whenever we do something, we must strike a balance in between the two issues, the economic development and the issue of environment. Thank you.
The kind of litigation that comes from the High Court comes under Article 1 or 2, if they describe it as a macro-level environmental jurisprudence that's coming up. The macro-level environmental disputes that come before the tribunals, I believe the role of the, it could be balanced, it could be protected the balance money if the tribunals could be strengthened as well. If I may ask you suggestions and advice on the environmental disputes that come before the tribunals.
Thank you, very important question. The person manning the tribunal is a judicial person. He has got no training on the environment. You see, the High Court Division judges, they will have some other experience in other matters, because much of the High Court Division judges coming from the bar, they have got immense experience in different fields. Whenever you put some of the judges in any of the issue, they feel easy because they have got the previous experience. But the people who are in the tribunal, they are from the subordinate judiciary, having a very, I must not say that the analogy I'm saying is an advantage, because of the fact that he has been admitted to his employment, and therefrom he is coming in the same direction what he has first achieved there. He has got no divergence in his mentality. So if you put him in the tribunal without giving any training to him, you cannot get much output from him. So the person who are to man the tribunal should be a skilled person on environmental issues, environmental study. Thereafter, you may expect that these tribunals will be much operative, much effective. One thing that if you do not know what is the environmental issue, and you have been given the responsibility sitting in the tribunal, and on the basis of the papers, you see the rules, you see the conservation rules, you have to decide the matter on the basis on sitting on the table in the court. But you have to go to the locality to see what is the impact. What is the impact of this particular development issue? That is not in the rule. So although the rules are the laws are adequate, but that requires change. And to get a maximum output from the tribunal, there should be a coherent policy regarding this issue. You are talking about the environment. We are talking about the environment. But can you say that this issue is that much of importance to the executives? No. So whenever they see that there is a conference, there is a convention in the international arena, they have to ratify it or to sign it, they do it. But afterward, they forget everything. Then whenever they make the step, their own conference on the other, they made their own wish. So that's the reason only. That maximum output is not coming from the tribunal.
One of the, from my personal opinion, my lord, I think one of the ways to get justice on environmental issues is to make violation of environmental laws very expensive for the perpetrators. Is there any precedent of making it very expensive for the perpetrators by imposing fines, penalties, or even punishments? In environmental cases that you have decided over?
Master plan of the Dhaka city. So what we did is, we did not fine, unfortunately, we should have, now that I've taken the point next time probably, that we had discharged the rule on the very ground that the plan of the Dhaka city was being sort of, what should I be saying, it was against the plan, number one, and then the waste management system, it could have been elsewhere, choosing a city, not in the, within the Dhaka city, not in the periphery of the Sonargaon, Sheraton, Shahbagh, Shahbagh board, it was from here to there. And the other bench that I presided over again, that was with regard to the commercial establishments, it's on the Dhanmundi. It's one of the Dhanmundi areas. And the other one was also, and now I remember, thank you, brother, for reminding me, this was with regard to the schools being established every Oli Goli in the Dhanmundi area. But I have not seen the implementation as yet, though we decided in favor of the petitioners, asking them to remove all these structures which are commercial in nature, giving them 5 years, and I think that was quite enough. Well, I'm not too sure whether 5 years have elapsed till date, but I guess it's been more than 3-4 years now that I was on that bench and then the commercial establishment was to be removed. But unfortunately, Mr. Chaudhary, we did not fine, but we had given a chance to remove those commercial establishments, especially. And let's see what the future tells. Over to Justice Rifat Ahmed for any. I think I'm a good moderator, yeah. Mr. Mustafa Jalal.
To answer your question, the polluters pay principle, I think, is being negotiated upon globally between offending states or the greater polluter states and the affected states like Bangladesh. It's a fairly complex mechanism and it's still in the process of being sort of sorted out. But that has the promise of apportioning responsibility, as it were. Whether we can sort of transport that into municipal law, I do not know. But that is one possibility that one can look into. The other thing is that sustainable development goals, the SDGs, we've done very, it a precursor kichilo, MDGs, Millennium Development Goals. Bangladesh has had a very good track record in meeting the MDGs overall. And definitely in the South Asian context. Our next challenge, however, is given the imminence, the degree, and the reality of climate change, how far we'll be able to meet the SDGs. And that is where the courts will have to come in. And I think that the courts will have to be far more proactive and anticipatory in dealing with these issues. Another development that has been of promise and has been court-driven, if I may add, is, I can't remember which amendment it was, but now, for the first time, we do not have to go and continue redefining what the components of right to life is, because that is where we brought, you know, the whole issue of environmental protection under. Now, for the first time in the last 7 years, I think we have fundamental principle state policy. We have the environmental protection as something that to guide our, you know, our policies on, and something that that the courts can build on, and it's for you, yeah, the bar to bring that forth, because it's now written in the constitution. So, you know, anything goes actually. Good luck.
Not that much. Occupied with the laws and policies and international norms about international law, and coming here, I got the totally different conception that they are concerned about it, and it is very much good sign. To be very specific, my question is, we are bargaining in World Forum for gaining much more amount in terms of climate fund, and we are bargaining for the enhancement of that particular fund. But will you, Honorable Justices, in High Court Division, give a particular direction as how we will allot the monies and how we will distribute for the proper causes and for making a good paradigm in this perspective? Have you any role in this regard?
Yeah, if it arises, we'll don't we direct the government to spend the fund in a certain manner.
So if I add something, that the cause of action is very common as we, as everything, is under the right to life and right to protection of law, and in interpreting that particular term, you can add something as related that we have seen in sexual harassment case, and I think suo motu.
Yes.
So you can.
But there is a principle of suo motu. Suo motu is not a suo motu thing. Suo motu has got some principle of that particular. I have said the cause of action, but that particular situation might arise. Whenever the High Court will act that the certain wrong has been committed by the government or the agency regarding the climate change fund, that has not arisen. But mind it, be sure, whenever it will arise, the High Court will not sit idle.
Change. The whole discourse has been very succinctly recorded in that judgment, and it is essential reading for students of environmental law, and it serves as, what should I say, as a reference point for this, the way ahead. So read that judgment.
Thank you all.
So thank you very much for your participation. It's very good to see that there are young students and practitioners who have also taken the opportunity to ask questions, and I'm also very grateful to the Justice A.F.M. Abdur Rahman to allow the other honorable judges of the Supreme Court of Bangladesh to also
share
their wisdom and knowledge. Thank you very much. I would like to have a conclusion of the evening.
Ladies and gentlemen, before concluding the event, I would just like to thank the team that has worked behind this event. The team comprised of, I would like to thank, besides myself and Ms. Anita Ghazi Islam, it was Mr. Mohibul Hasan Chaudhary, Mr. Anisul Hassan, who is not here, Mr. Ahmed Zakir Chaudhary, and the volunteers were Ms. Tazin, Ms. Tasina, Saeed, Rifat, Rahman, Noreen, and Farah from the legal circle, and Saeed from Dr. Kamal Hussain and Associates. So a big round of applause for their volunteers, please.
My thanks to everybody. All the names have been uttered. All thanks to all of them. Thank you.